So let's get started, guys. Hello, everyone. This is Satyajit Patnaik, and welcome to my channel. In case you are new to this channel, please subscribe the channel and hit the bell icon to get notified on my future videos and sessions. Today, we shall be discussing about one of the most important and most common use cases, which is widely used in any kind of industry. The most common issue that any company faces is to retain their existing customers, be it gaming industry, banking, telecom. You can name any industry. In order to retain the customers who are willing to leave the system is a challenging task. Okay, so today we will be talking about the customer retention use case, and we will try to understand the customer behavior and attributes that may be useful in identifying the characteristics of the churners. If we are able to identify such insights, that might help us in the model building part. So today's session is an end-to-end machine learning project related session where we will get started with the business insight understanding. And then using the mockup data, we'll try to perform EDA, exploratory data analysis, get some insights, and using those insights, we'll try to build our model and then try to deploy it. Okay. The difficulty of this project is considered to be intermediate as per the given data, but in real scenarios, the difficulty might increase as well depending upon the data's complexity. So let's quickly get started on this. In case you have any question in the middle of the session, you can post it as a comment or in the live chat, and I'll try to get back to you with the answers. If your questions are somehow missed, you can definitely reach out to me directly. The links to my LinkedIn profile should already be a part of the description below. Let's quickly get started, guys. Now, before jumping into the use case, our today's use case is all about customer churn prediction. Okay, customer retention. But my data is all around telecom data, telecom related data. But before that, let's talk about gaming industry. Now, how this churn prediction or how customer retention is important in gaming industry. Now, for example, you're playing some games and at some point of time, you stop playing it. Okay, let's say you have already been playing since last 1 year or maybe last 6 months. At a particular point of time, you have stopped playing it. What could be the probable reasons for that? The probable reasons could be you are at stage 103. That stage is quite difficult to clear. You have been trying from the past 5-6 days and you are not able to clear. Or there could be another reason that from the past couple of days, you are easily clearing all the levels. That could also be one of the reasons why the difficulty level is too easy for you, so customers are likely to churn. Okay, now the same fundamentals are applicable to each and every industry. Coming into the banking industry, telecom industry, customer churning is a very common problem. Okay, now in telecom, there are scenarios where you are currently using Vodafone and then you move to Jio or you move to Airtel. What could be the possible reasons for that? The possible reasons could be maybe you are on a very higher plan, maybe 500 rupees plan a month, and that particular plan is available in different telcos with a very less cost, maybe 200, 300. Or there could be another reason like service disruption. For example, you are staying in a remote area, or maybe you are staying in an urban area, but in that particular area, you have some coverage issue. So that basically helps the customer to churn the system. They are so pissed off with the network, they likely to check out for different options. So that is also one of the reasons why people churn. Now we will talk about in depth what basically retention is, what are the different churn segments. We will try to understand the problem statement, and then based on that, we'll take some actions. Yeah, pricing is one of the reasons as well. So today's topic is going to be around telecom. So my slides are all related to telecom. This is one of my use cases, one of my slides which I have used in my current company. Okay. Now, telecom retention using data science to address customer churn. So this is the background. Now, in the first 15 minutes, we'll talk about the use case. We'll talk about and we'll try to understand in depth. And then I'll show you the data, and then I'll show you how to perform the EDA and all those things in Python. Okay, so the background is operators are losing share in today's competitive market. Industry and external outlook, tougher telecom environment, smarter and more demanding customers, and the internal look, tremendous growth potential, key questions that clients ask around churn. How can I understand my churn situation better, both at the organizational and the subscriber levels? Okay, churn is a very important key. Now, the next slide is all about the different types of churn. Churning is not very specific that you are moving from Airtel to Jio. That's also churning, but churning is also considered as, an example would be moving from a 500 rupees plan to a 100 rupees plan. That is a loss to the company, right? Because the company was making a money of 500 rupees a month. From the next month, you have moved to a 100 rupees plan. That is also called as churning. So these are the four major types of churning, very specific to telecom domain. When it comes to other domain, based on your domain knowledge, you can note down all these different churning scenarios. So as you can see, the first topic is tariff plan churn. Moving from a 50 euros to 30 euros monthly. Very similar example which I told right now. Moving from a 500 rupees plan to a 100 rupees plan. Service churn, weekly, monthly subscription. So maybe you are churning the services. Product churn could be moving from postpaid to prepaid. Because postpaid is like every month you have to pay a certain amount, 499 or 399. But in prepaid, it has been seen that customers, some months you might charge for 500, you might do a recharge for 500, some months you might do for 100. So in postpaid, the companies are in more beneficial, right? So product churning is also one of the types of churn. And then comes your usage churn, which is example is inactive or zero usage. Okay, now you can at least relate what could be the different churn scenarios based on that. I'm not pretty sure, Archin. I think this could be the same one. Decision cycle of a subscriber. Okay. Now, this particular slide will explain you each and everything. At least it will give you an idea about the different types of churning and what are the different segments, how customers behave, all this kind of idea it will be giving. Now, let's consider the first. Let's say I am a mobile customer. Okay. Now, you can think from a customer's point of view. When I'm talking about this particular scenarios, you can think yourself, I'm a mobile customer and I haven't thought about churning. Okay, when I'm a customer, there are two different thoughts, right? There are two different possibilities, whether I'm interested to churn or whether I'm not interested to churn, right? So let's discuss about when I'm not interested to churn. So I'm a mobile customer and I haven't thought about churning. Now, inside that also, there are three different scenarios. I haven't thought about churning because the process is too complex. Many people think that who would churn, who would leave Airtel, who would leave Vodafone and go to Jio. There is a lot of documentation work. There is a lot of portability work, porting and all those things. I have to go to the customer care. I have to go to this, that. So many people are lazy. That is a major reason why people don't churn. Those kind of customers are called as inert subscribers or inert customers. Okay, they haven't thought about churning because either the processes are too complex or they don't have time, right? The second one is, I haven't thought about churning because my operator is best. These are unconditionally loyal customers. I also have live examples in my friend list, in my colleagues. Is the slide not quite clear? Maybe it could be because of one of the reasons for your net pack or something like that. But for me, it's looking clear. Anybody has any issues with the slides? Okay. Okay, so the second type of customer is, I haven't thought about churning because my operator is best to me. So these are unconditionally loyal customers. A live example is my father itself. He has been using BSNL since the past 20 years, I would say, and he's still okay with it. Today's scenario, I have given him other options. Why don't you move to this? Why don't you move to that? But he's still okay with BSNL. So that kind of customers are unconditionally loyal customers. Okay. Now the third category is, now coming on to the customers who have thought about churning. People who have thought about churning and they are locked in any contract period. For example, postpaid customers might have taken a contract, maybe a 1 year contract or a 2 years contract. So let's say your monthly charges are 500, but companies sell in that way. If you take the yearly contract, with respect to 6,000, you will have to pay 3,000 or 4,000. So they are binded to a contract, because of which, even if they think to churn, they are not able to churn. They are not able to leave the company because of the contract. They are locked in subscribers, and you can also consider them as non-churning customers because they are tied up with contracts. Now, the next category is customers who have thought about churning and they are not locked in any contract. And then I have decided to stay. They are conditionally loyal. Okay. They have thought about churning. They don't have any contract, but somehow they are managing to stay, decided to stay. Let's continue. Let's see what happens in the next two months or 3 months. We will see. We will decide. These are conditionally loyal. Okay. Now the next customers are thought about churning. They don't have contract locking, and they have decided to go because of multiple reasons. Because they have found a better offer. Let's say I told about, like, I'm using Vodafone. I have got a better offer from Airtel. I will churn. So these are conditional churn customers. Either they have a better offer, or their needs have changed, or they are not satisfied because of multiple reasons. These are the customers who are likely to churn. These are considered as conditional churner, lifestyle migrators, and unsatisfied churners. Okay, quite clear with this particular slide. I'll just keep it open for next 1 minute so that you can just have a look at it. Maybe I will try to share the slides as well, but I have to check if I can share or not. But this is how the decision cycle looks like for a subscriber. Now the different churn segments. We already saw this here that different customers are in-app subscribers, unconditionally loyal customers, conditionally loyal customers, lifestyle migrators, and unsatisfied churners, right? So these are the four different churn segments. Conditionally loyal subscriber frequently reevaluates purchase decisions, choose brand on semi-rotational basis, likes to change to test new products. Okay, these type of customers are called as conditionally loyal subscribers. They are very likely to churn at any point of time. Okay. Conditional churner, lifestyle migrator, and unsatisfied churners. You have already understood each and every subcategory of the customers, right? Now the next topic is going to be, this is a proactive approach to managing churn, has data science at its heart. So this basically slide is all about how the acquisition happens, how the customer engagement happens. We'll not go in depth in this particular slide. I will try to share this slide with you so that you can go through in your leisure time. The next slides are more likely to be like the solutions, because as I told, this particular slide was meant for my previous company. Okay. So this is a very high level overview of a data science led approach to manage churn. So the first category is capture and analyze. This is the EDA part where we have to understand the data, get some insights, get the business understanding, and then proceed with the model building part. The second step is nothing but report and predict. So this is the area where we have to create a predictive model so that our model will be able to predict the customers in advance. Now, only when we predict the customers, then only we can take some actions onto it, right? So that's the reason the third category is engage and act. So list of churn drivers, KPIs for tracking and monitoring, a generated list of recommended subscribers for target churn campaigns. Because ultimate goal is to identify the customers who are likely to churn, and based on their categories, let's say there is a customer one and there is a customer two. Our model will predict both as likely to be churned in next 6 months. But how do we tackle with the offering system? Like, how do we tackle to retain them? So for that, we have to identify these two customers are falling in which category. Is customer one conditionally loyal, or is customer one is a lifestyle migrator, or he's an unsatisfied churner? Okay, there could be possibilities, right? That two types of customers are falling in two different categories. So based on two different categories, we will have to plan. So in that planning, along with data scientist, higher management, sales team, pre-sales team, a lot of teams combine together and they form the strategies, right? Everybody clear? So this is a very high level overview, as I already told, capture and analyze, report and predict, and then engage and act. So these are some of the data from various sources and aggregation which has to be done for the predictive model. Now look at this data. We have customer and demographics data, usage and reload data, like whether the usage is more in the nighttime or in the daytime, what kind of usage, what is the bandwidth. All these are very important for these kind of prediction models, right? Customer segmentation or campaign data. Now, campaign data are very important because whenever some new services are provided by the companies, they usually give the links for sharing the feedbacks, right? Many of you might already been knowing about that. So based on that feedback, it's a normal trend that at least 5 to 10% reply in that feedbacks, right? So those campaign data could also be very, you know, very informative or very useful for the model building part, right? And we have survey related data, external data. So as much data as possible, you can start collecting. When you start building these models in the real industries, you start collecting data, because in real industries, your data is not present in Kaggle, right? In Kaggle, you can easily download the data and create a model, which is like, I can create any model from a Kaggle dataset in like 15 to 30 minutes. But that's not the case in real scenarios, right? When in real scenarios, in real industries, you have the data collection part is the most hectic part. Okay, identify which team is the owner of which kind of data, because mostly what happens in MNCs, not a single team owns the entire data. There would be some team who would be taking care of the customer details. There would be some team who would be taking care of the survey related data. There could be some team who would be taking care of the ticketing related data. So you have to manage everything, talk to those teams and start collecting the data. Now, once you start collecting the data, then the second problematic situation is the insight gathering. So EDA and data collection are the most important topics in any data science industries, in any data science jobs, right? And model building part is quite easy. So this is somehow the overall point of view, how the data should look like. As much data as possible, if you can collect all this kind of data, that would be very, very, very useful for your use cases. Okay. So these are the same slides, nothing but we have just explained in a very detailed manner how to capture and analyze and all those things. Let's jump into the next particular slide, which is a building a predictive churn model and using its output to generate a target list. That's the main motive of this particular session, that we have to create a predictive churn model. Let's say I have customers' details, gender, geography, contract type, etc., etc. A lot of features I have collected. Based on those features, our very first task is to identify the important characteristics of churners. Because if we identify the important characteristics of churners, based on that, we can create a model, and the model will be able to predict a new customer. If we feed a new customer to the model, it will predict that whether this customer is likely to churn in next 6 months or 12 months or 18 months. And based on that, we can create our next, our next task, like what to do. Once we have the list of customers, what's next? Okay, so this is basically the idea of this particular session. Segmenting the model output for target retention campaigns. So today's use case is all about creating the predictive model and then deploying it. But once you do this particular use case, a lot of use cases opens up in your real industries. Once you have the target list of customers who are likely to churn, what's next? Then based on the customers, you can also do some clustering techniques and do some other techniques where you can analyze the different segments of the customers. Okay, those topics we will not cover in this particular session because it will be very lengthy. But yeah, today in this session, we will try to create a model which will be able to predict the churners or not churners. Okay, This is a future scope, as I already told. Once this model is ready, once you have a very clear understanding on the churn prediction model, then you can think about what's next, how to provide offers, how to retain those kind of customers, how to identify the different segments of customers, and et cetera, okay. So I'll just skip this slide. This is nothing but the customer lifecycle management. It starts from the customer segmentation, acquisition, offer optimization. This is where the lifetime value management is done, highest customer engagement. And at certain point of time, customer engagement starts falling. That's where you start creating your cross-selling models, upselling models, and all those things, usage campaigns and retention analytics. So let's jump into the last slide. I don't want to take a lot of time. So this is the solution overview, which I already talked about. Developing a customer 360 degrees view, behavioral segmentation of data, building churn predictive models, and generating lists for campaigns. Okay, this is the final solution which we will be doing in this particular slide, in this particular session. Let me open the data. So this is one of the data sets which I have taken from Kaggle itself. So I will try to explain. Let me just zoom in a little bit. Okay, I hope the data is visible. The data, this is the data set. Okay, I have customer ID, I have gender, senior citizen, partner, dependents, tenure, phone service, multiple lines, and there are a lot of features. And I also have a tag called as churn. That means whether a customer has churned or not churned. Right. Now, in order to do that, we have to do one thing. We have to first analyze what is the ratio of the customers who are getting churned with respect to the non-churners. That's the first motive of this particular EDA process. Okay. For EDA, I already have written the code because if I just write down code from scratch, it will take a lot of time. So I have already written the codes, but I will go through each one of them. Okay. Now just try to understand this particular use case. Let me draw this and help you understand. Okay. So this is a classic telecom churn use case, telecom churn prediction use case. Okay. So here I have a lot of data, customer ID, I have gender, I have geography, so I don't have geography here, it's okay. Senior citizen, I have partner, and et cetera, I have a contract type. What is the contract type I have? And then I have churn. That means the customer is churn or not churn. The first thing, the first and foremost thing, what we need to do is to identify the ratio of churners. Now, let's say in this particular use case, I will show you the ratio is somewhere like 73 is to 27. Okay, that means 27% of the customers are churners. They have left the system. And 73% customers are active or they are loyal customers. Okay, so our model is basically we have to create a model based on all this data. So let's say this is the model. Now the model will be able to predict when a new customer comes in, new customer or old customer also. This model will also work for old customers. I will also tell you that. For new customers, if you feed the data that this is the data, it will tell you whether this customer is going to be churned or not churned. Okay. If you also want to create a model like whether this customer will be churned in 12 months or 6 months or 18 months, then also a minor tweak is required in the model code, and that is also possible. So you can identify the customer is going to be churned or not churned. Now, let's talk about EDA. Exploratory data analysis is nothing but getting insights. Okay. So I will just start from the basics. When we deal with the features, these are the features, right? These are the X variables. Okay. These are the independent variables. And my churn is the dependent variable, right? This is the Y variable, and these are my X variables. Now, when you see the data, you can see that gender is a categorical variable, partner is a categorical variable, dependents is a categorical variable, tenure is a numerical variable. Okay, so quite clear there are two types of variables, which is categorical and second one is numerical. Okay, so there are different analysis which has to be done in these two categories. So let's talk about categorical data. So what happens is, in EDA, as I already told, we have to find the characteristics of the churners. Only when we understand what type of churners are there, whether more churners are male or female, whether more churners are senior citizen or not, those insights will help us in the model building part. Okay, so the first step is going to be doing a univariate analysis. Now, univariate analysis is analyzing one single variable. Okay, when I talk about this particular use case, normally univariate means one variable itself, but here, with context to this particular use case, when I say univariate analysis, that means I'm going to analyze one variable along with churn. Okay, so my first thing is univariate analysis. Okay, in general, univariate analysis means single variable. Now, if you have gender, you have to identify out of gender, what is the distribution? Let's say male 51% and female 49%. That is basically univariate analysis. Okay, but in this use case, when I say univariate analysis, what I mean is I need to understand with respect to churners. Okay, now let's say I have 1,000 records. Out of 1,000 records, let's say 2,500 are churners. Okay, so I'm just considering this data, considering the churner data. Okay, you can either do this way, you can create a new data frame for these 2,500 records, and then do your analysis. It's up to you. Okay, but what I need to do is I need to find the gender distribution for churners. Now, let's say out of 2,500, I found that 1,300 are male and 1,200 are female. Now, what is the ratio? Almost 55% or 52% and 48%, something like that, right? Now, 52 and 48 are very close to 50-50 ratio. So we cannot tell that if you are a male, you are more likely to churn as compared to female. If the ratio would have been 1,500:100, then the ratio is quite larger, right? In this case, you can tell that, okay, when you are a male, you are more likely to churn, right? Similarly, in this univariate analysis, you have to analyze each and everything. You have to analyze gender, you have to analyze citizen, you have to analyze partner, you have to analyze all the categorical variables, and you have to see the distribution, how the distribution looks like. Now let's talk about contract type. When you see the contract type, there are three different valid values. One is monthly, one is one yearly. Yeah, I will tell about the plotting part as well when we talk about the coding part. Here we are just understanding the use case. Okay, so monthly customers, 1 year and 2 year. Now what I need to do is, out of the 2,500 customers that I have, the not the original customer list, the churners list. Okay, I need to analyze what is the distribution of monthly, yearly and 2 yearly. Let's say I found that monthly customers are 2,000, just an example. Yearly customers are 300 and 2 yearly are 200. So here we can identify that more customers, like almost 80% customers are having the monthly contract type. So a very good reason is that they are not binded with any contract, so they are easily churnable. So they easily churn. Okay, that is one easy example, one easy reason. Now, when I talk about male and female, let's say I have a 50-50 ratio, but does that mean that gender is not important? With the ratio that I have, let's say I have a 50-50 ratio distribution of male and female, does that mean that gender is not important? Does that mean we have to ignore gender from the model building part? The answer is no. Now, why? Because apart from univariate analysis, there could be multiple other analysis which has to be done. Let's move into bivariate analysis. bivariate is nothing but analyzing two variables. Okay. Similarly, after bivariate, three variable analysis, multiple variable analysis, and it goes on. Okay. So let's consider the bivariate analysis. Now, when I do the bivariate analysis, let's say I'm considering gender and contract type. Okay. Now, obviously, I know that monthly customers are the highest churners, right? 2000 customers. So yearly customers, let's just do this way. This is the yearly customers, 300, 200, let's say 150. This is for male, this is for female, this is for male, this is for female. Okay. It's a 50-50 ratio for 1 yearly contracts and 2 yearly contracts. And when I see the monthly to monthly contracts, I can see that 60% are males, 40% are females. Okay. That means out of 2000, 1200 are males and 800 are females. Now here I can get an idea that gender standalone variable, when I did a univariate analysis, my gender was not giving me more insights, right? It was a 50-50 ratio distribution. But when it came to a bivariate analysis, now we can see that male monthly customers are more likely to churn as compared to female monthly customers. Okay, that's a good insight that we got. Similarly, you have to do all the permutations and combinations of all these variables, univariate, bivariate, and the list goes on. Now, how to do the three variable analysis? Let's say gender, contract type, and whether the citizen is senior citizen or not. What you need to do? Let's say you bifurcate this data, you get the list of 2000 customers. Out of this 2000 customers, I already told 60% are male and 40% are female, right? So this is 1200 and this is 800. Now out of this 1200, I have seen that almost 605 are senior citizen and 595 are not senior citizen. Here, out of 800, let's say 600 are senior citizen and 600 are non-senior citizen and 200 are senior citizen. Okay. Now here you can say that male senior citizen churners almost 50-50 ratio, right? 50:50. But here you get an insight that females who are not senior citizen are more likely to churn. Okay. This is just an example what I'm giving. So this is how you have to perform all these analysis. And that is the reason why I told that exploratory data analysis is going to be very difficult. And it is, to be very honest, in the real industries, I know that 80% of the industries are more reliable on the EDA part. Very few companies build a predictive model. Okay. Because building a model is not a big deal. You can easily build a model. Hardly in a week or 2 weeks, you can easily fine tune a model and build it. But EDA, getting insights, is more important. Many companies are there who take decisions based on these EDA analysis. Okay. Now everybody is clear with this part. Now coming on to the numerical analysis. Now numerical analysis is all about numerical data, right? Now how numerical data are related to each other? So there is a concept called as correlation. Now what is correlation? Can anybody start typing in if you know what is correlation? Correlation is nothing but how your variables are correlated with each other. Now correlation matrix always ranges from minus 1 to 1. People who are having a basics of statistics, they can easily relate it. Now the range differs from minus 1 to 1. Where if the value is very near to 1, maybe 0.9 or 0.8, for example, numerical variables, let's say I have monthly charges and I have, senior citizen, okay, senior citizen or tenure, let's say tenure, I have tenure, okay, tenure means how old is the customer in the system? That means how, since when he is in the system. Okay, 10 years 60 means he's in the system from the past 60 months, 5 years. Okay, so I have monthly charges and I have tenure. When I see a correlation of these two is 0.9. That means they are highly positively correlated. Yeah, df.core function is basically used. Okay, 0.9 or 0.8 means they are highly correlated. That means increase in monthly charges tends to increase in tenures, or vice versa. Increase in tenure tends to increase in monthly charges. Okay, now when the correlation function is very close to zero, or maybe minus 0.2 to 0.2, this is not, there is no thumb rule for that. I'm just giving an example. Okay, when it is falling between this particular range, then it is said that they are not related to each other. Let's say monthly charges and tenure are having a value of 0.1. That means they are not related to each other, neither positively correlated nor negatively correlated. That means increase in tenure and increase in monthly charges are not related to each other. There is no such pattern. Now, minus 1 or very close to minus 1, minus 9.9, minus 0.8, something like that. That means they are negatively correlated. That means increase in tenure, we have seen that when the tenure increases, the monthly charges decreases. Right? So all these things are done, categorical analysis and numerical analysis. Based on this, we find insights. Okay. So let's move into the EDA part. Let's move into the coding part. So in the code, I have already written the code, but again, I will share the code with you all. So if you just go through this particular code, you can easily perform EDA for any kind of use cases. Okay, the concepts remain same, but yeah, how you project, how you create the visualizations, whether you're using a scatter plot or this plot or that plot, that depends upon user to user. Okay, how you make your insights more attractive. Some people do their EDA on various other tools as well, like Excel or Power BI or Tableau. There are multiple ways where you can do your data visualization and data insight gathering, right? We are just using Python is just one of them. If correlation is greater than 0.2, so from 0.2 to 0.4, that means you can see that the ratio, like increase in tenure, is not highly correlated with monthly charges, but they are correlated, right? That's the main idea. So this is a use case. I already showed you the use case. I have customer ID, gender, senior citizen, partner, dependents, and etc. etc. So let's move ahead with the problem with the EDA part. Sample data set containing telecom customer data and showing customers left last month. Okay. So let me just run this particular code. Let me restart the kernel so that we can run it from scratch. Okay, I have run the code. Model building, we will do it from scratch. Okay, so EDA, it's going to be very lengthy. If I just go through EDA from scratch, if I start writing the code, it will be more than 3 to 4 hours to finish. Okay, so I have read the data set, and this is how the data set looks like. You can see customer ID, gender, senior citizen, partner, etc., etc. A lot of things are there. Okay. Now, we are just doing a shape. Shape means how many rows do we have and how many columns do we have. Okay, this is the number of rows and this is the number of columns. Next step is I'm just checking the values. I'm just seeing what are the column types, customer ID, gender, senior citizen, partner, dependents, and etc. etc. All these columns are visible. Now, the next step is we have to check the data types of these columns. Okay, let me zoom it. Thank you for highlighting. Okay, let's check the data types of these columns. So if I run this code, you can see customer ID is object, gender is object, integer, some are float, some are objects. Okay. Now describe. Anybody knows about describe function? Describe basically is used for the numerical variables, which will give you an insight what is the mean, what is the total count of these customers, total count of this column, what is the maximum value, what is the minimum value, what is the 25th percentile, 50th percentile, 75th percentile value, all these. So this is basically a statistical, descriptive statistics kind of thing for numerical variables. Okay. Now, anybody knows why we are just able to see senior citizen tenure and monthly charges, why not others? Even if some other columns like monthly charges or total charges, why are not able to see total charges here? Because total charges is an object, it's not a float. So we have to convert total charges to object, float variable or integer variable. Okay, so you can see some of the insights is that senior citizen is actually a categorical, hence 25, 50, 75 distribution is not proper. Okay, senior citizen is in the forms of zeros and ones. But here, as you can see, the type is integer. That's the reason it is shown here, but it's not relevant for us. 75% of the customers have tenure less than 55 months. You can see the 75th percentile value is 55 and tenure is in months, right? 60 means 5 years, 60 months. So 55 months is basically the 75th percentile. That means 75% customers have tenure less than 55 months. Okay. Now next is also monthly charges. The average monthly charges are $64. You can see the mean value is 64. Now what is mean? What is mean and how mean is differentiated with average? What is the difference between mean and average? Can somebody tell me in the comment section or in the live chat? What is the difference between mean and average? So this is the mean value, the monthly charges. Okay. So the next topic is going to be plotting. So before plotting, I will also talk about some of the concepts, how to convert a categorical variable into numerical and how to convert a numerical variable into categorical. Okay. So obviously I have it covered in this particular slide. So, okay, let's cover and on the go, I will explain. So in these kind of problems where you are dealing with a classification problem, we're dealing with churners versus non-churners or credit card holders, approvals versus rejected or any kind of classification type of problems. Our first thing is what I already told when I was explaining is we are more concerned about understanding the characteristics of churners, right? So the main and the first foremost point is to identify what is the churners ratio. So I have used this particular bar plot to get the churners ratio. You can see yes is almost around, I don't see the exact values here because I haven't passed the labels, but I have it here. When I do a value counts, so you can simply do value counts. I'll just show you how value counts work. So if you do value counts, it will give you an idea about what is the total distribution of this particular column. I'm passing the column name dot value counts. Okay. So it has told me that 5,174 is no and 1,869 is yes. Now you can also do this way to calculate the percentage. We usually do this way, right? Adding both the values, this plus 5,174,7043. So this divided by 7043 is my total number of churners percentage, right? 0.26. That's the same thing what I have done here. 100 into the value counts divided by the total length of the churners. Okay. So the non-churners are 73% and the churners are 26%. Yeah. Thank you, Meena. So the same. Yeah, I skipped the same thing. Mean and average are almost similar to each other. They could be called as synonyms, but mean is a very statistical term where it depends upon the population which you are talking about, right? Let's say you have 1,000 population, but in your data, you are just using 10 records. So the mean of those 10 records would be average of those 10 records, right? Mean is a statistical term. But yeah, conceptually, it is very similar to average. So I already have the churn ratio. So the data is highly imbalanced. This is the first insight that we got, right? Now, what is imbalanced data? People who who are attending this session, I believe somebody has at least the basic knowledge on the problem statements, right? So there are two scenarios. When you are dealing with these kind of classification problems, let me zoom it because my handwriting is not looking good here. Okay, classification problem. So in this particular case, we have two classes. Okay, what are the two classes? Churn as yes and no. When you are dealing with diabetes or non-diabetes, what are the two classes? Diabetes or non-diabetes. When you are dealing with some other use cases like cats and dogs, two classes are cats and dogs. So this is a binary classification problem, right? So the two classes in this particular problem is whether the customer is yes or no. So the first thing what we need to do is identify the yes is to no ratio. We have already identified this is 73:27 ratio. Now what is imbalanced data? Imbalanced data means this data is not 50-50 or even 45-55 is also called as balanced data. Okay. Now, when you have balanced data, when you create your model, let's say you're creating a model on 50:50 ratio data. That means 50 are cats and 50 are dogs. That means the model is trained on 50 records each on these classes, right? So the model which is created here is definitely a efficient model. But let's say I have the distribution like this, 90:10. So 90 cats and 10 dogs. Obviously, the model created will not be efficient because 90 cats has more information, more characteristics, more information, more traits as compared to these 10 dogs, right? So 10 pictures of dogs, right? So less information is being transferred for class B and more information is transferred for class A. So there is a concept called as overfitting. So overfitting means when you overfit your model, when you train more, your model is more giving more accuracy on the training data and less accuracy in the test data. Okay. But here, if I don't have to create a machine learning model, I can simply create a model and I will hard code it. Any image, predict it as cat. And I have 100 pictures. 90 are cats and 10 are dogs. Now, if these images are trained into this model, just I'm repeating myself, this is the machine learning model. This is the programming model. Okay. This is the machine learning model. This is the programming model. Here, I have just used one line of code, any picture. Predict it as cat. In an imbalanced data set, what happens is if I pass this model, still 90 records, I will be able to predict it properly, right? 10 records, I will not be able to predict it. So 90% accuracy. Will accuracy be considered in this kind of problems? The answer is no. Because in imbalanced problems, accuracy is cursed. Accuracy is cursed. Okay, and there are some other concepts like recall precision we will learn in the meanwhile. But yeah, imbalanced data set. Now, how to deal with imbalanced data sets? There are different techniques as well. Let me explain you those techniques as well. Imbalanced data set. Let's say I have here, let's say I have 73% non-churners and 27% churners. So there are two different techniques to deal with this. Let's say here I have 5,000 records and here I have 2,000 records. Okay. So one technique is upsampling and one technique is downsampling. Okay. Now what is upsampling? Upsampling means creating synthetic records for the low class. Let's say the second class is the churners. I have 2,000 records. Right. What if I create synthetically, I create 5,000 records from this. Now, how to create synthetically? Copy paste. Copy 2,000 records and create 3,000 copies out of it. And just rename few features. Okay, just rename the names and rename some features, right? So this is basically upsampling. So ultimately, your model has 7,000 records. Now your model is being trained with 10,000 records, that is 5,000 for class 1, 5,000 for class 2. This is upsampling model. Now what happens is downsampling. So downsampling means the lower class, 2,000 records. And from upper class, arbitrarily we pick 2,000 records. Now we build a model with this 4,000 records, and this model will be, this is a balanced model, right? 2000 is to 2000, 50 is to 50. This is downsampling. So it has been normally seen that upsampling give you better results as compared to downsampling, because in upsampling you have more data, right? Here the model is created in 4K records. Here the model is created in 10K records. So obviously in 80 to 90% of the cases, upsampling will give you better results. But in some scenarios, we have also seen that downsampling also performs better than upsampling. So it depends. You have to do an R&D, you have to do, and then only you can finalize this. So everybody clear with the imbalanced data set? Okay, that is the reason. Our first and foremost task is to check the values of the Y variable. Okay. So here we have already got the Y variable 73 is to 26, right? And these are the initial insights which we got. Data is highly imbalanced, ratio is 73:27. So we analyze the data and other features while taking the target values separately to get some insights. Yeah, in downsampling, some of the data is lost because instead of 5,000, you are arbitrarily choosing 2,000 records, right? So there are quite a high possibility that in those 3,000 neglected records, you might miss out some information, some traits, right? Okay, I'll explain upsampling and downsampling again. Let's consider I have 10,000 records. Sorry, I have 7,000 records. Okay, 7,000 records in which 5,000 are non-churners and 2,000 are churners, right? So if I train a model, my model will be a biased model, or it is called as, the model will not be accurately built because it is taking more information from class A and less information from class B. So it will definitely give you a very less accuracy, a less recall and less precision. Okay, when it comes to the practical part, you will understand. So to deal with this problem, what we need to do is we should always create a model on balanced data set. Now, how to make it balanced? Because this data set is already imbalanced, right? How to make it balanced? So what we need to do is there are two techniques. One is upsampling and one is downsampling. Now in upsampling, what we need to do is we have to consider the upper class. In downsampling, we have to consider the lower class. Here, in upsampling, what we will do is non-churners, 5,000 records are taken. Churners, 2,000 are taken. What we do is we synthetically copy-paste and create 5,000 records. Copy-paste or do something. When it comes to images, there are different techniques how you can synthetically create. There is a concept called as image augmentation. If you are not familiar, if you want to go through such particular examples, there is one more video in my channel itself on CNN. You can understand how augmentation works. Okay. So you synthetically create the records, 5,000, 5,000, and then you build your model. Now your model is built on 10,000 records, 50 is to 50, and then it gives you the output and gives you the accuracy. Downsampling, what happens in downsampling? For churners, we have 2,000 records. For non-churners, we arbitrarily pick 2,000 records. Out of this 5,000, we pick 2,000 records. So our model is again built on balanced data, 2,000 into 2,000. So on top of 4,000 records, the model is built. So normally it is seen that upsampling is better than downsampling in terms of results. Okay. And one more disadvantage of downsampling is that when you are arbitrarily taking 2,000 records, that means you are ignoring the 3,000 records, right? So information, useful information might be lost in this particular step. That is the reason it is always recommended to do upsampling rather than downsampling. But as I already told, machine learning is all about hit and trial. So there is no right or wrong. You have to hit and trial. It all depends upon your output. If downsampling is giving you better output, better results, that's the end goal. That's going to be your key, right? You have to focus on downsampling. So let's move into the ADA part. Let's not deviate from the topic. So here what I have done is I have, so dataframe.info. Dataframe.info basically gives you the information of the non-null objects. Like here I can see customer ID 7043 non-null. Let's say for contract, the value here is 7000. That means 7000 non-null objects, that means 43 null objects. So if there are null objects, you have to take care of that part. But there is one more catch. I will talk about that. Again, this is also one of the code which I had created for finding the percentage of missing values. Same piece of code can be reused for any EDA use cases. Okay. As you can see, all the variables are having 0% of null missing values. Now, what is missing value? What happens is, in your industry level problem statement, there are various scenarios where you could also come across situations where a particular column is having more missing values. Okay, I'll talk about that part first. Let me just recreate a paint file. Okay, so let's talk about missing values. Okay, now let's say I have a column called as anything. Let's say monthly charges. Okay, out of 10,000 records, 5,000 records have data, 5,000 records are null. So the normal thumb rule is, if this particular column is not related to anything, any other columns, and if you have more than 30 to 40% of missing values, then you can drop this column. Okay. And again, this 30 to 40% depends upon use case to use case. Okay. Because when you drop a column, you have to have the business understanding, then only you can drop the column, right? Only if you have a domain knowledge, you know that this column might not be useful, then you can drop it. And again, this particular percentage differs from use case to use case. Some developers drop columns where there are more than 40% missing values. Some drop when there are more than 50% missing values, and so on. One more scenario I will explain where we don't have to drop such columns. Okay. Now, one example is, let's say I have a column called as isCar. isCar means whether the customer has car or not, no car, right? Right. So isCar means whether the customer has car or no, not. YN, and let's say 40% customers are having car, 60% are not having car, right? There is one more column called as car type. Okay, now car type means which type of car, whether it is SUV, XUV, or a small car. I'm just giving an example. I don't have much idea about cars and all those things. Just giving a small example. Or else let's say car type means the brand. Okay. Now, obviously for N, it will be null, right? For N, it will be null because they don't have car. So obviously car type will be null, right? So Y means they have car. Which type of car? Maruti. They have car. Which type of car? Kia. Yes, which type of car? Tata Sumo, something like that. Okay, now this particular column, 100%, 60% of the column values will have null values, right? Because 60% of the customers don't have cars, which means 60% missing values, 60% null values. Shall we drop this column?
Now, if I don't have the domain knowledge and I don't know that these two are interrelated to each other, I can drop this column. But this is not correct, right? Because only when you have domain knowledge, then only you will have an understanding that we shouldn't drop this column because this column is related to this column. Instead of that, you can just fill it with something else. No car. Okay, or something like that. Right? So this column is very important. That's the reason I told you that you have to see, you have to analyze, and then only you can drop the columns. Now, if you have less amount of missing values, let's say 5% of missing values. 5% of the records are missing values for a particular column. Let's say out of 1,000 records, 6 records or 5 records or 10 records or 50 records are not having data. They are having missing value. So how to fill up missing values? There are multiple techniques how to fill it up. One technique could be finding the average of the values and filling it up. One technique would be implementing a time series forecasting model and forecast the values and then fill the model, then fill the data. One technique could be a window level filling, window filling, rolling window filling. Now, rolling window means, let's say you are dealing with a yearly data, right? 2015, 2016. Now, you don't take the entire average, rather than that, you take the rolling average only for 2015 or only for 2016, and then you fill it up. Or else you fill the previous value. This is also one of the techniques. Fill the previous value. So there are multiple ways where you can fill the missing values. It depends from use case to use case. After filling the missing values, you have to run the model, you have to see the accuracy, and that's where you can compare that in the first process, this is accuracy, second process, this is accuracy. Nobody will give you an accurate reason that this has to be used. Down the line, when you start working on these models, you will easily identify, you will easily understand which scenarios should you use first, but there is no such thumb rule for that. Okay, it's a hit and try. Yeah, for categorical variables, you can use the most repeated value, and for numerical variables, you can do these kind of techniques, right? Or else you can also, sometimes we can also create a new categorical variable like null or none or something like that. It depends, right? Everybody clear with the missing value part? So let's go back to the use case. Sorry. Okay. So as I told you, this code is self-explanatory. You can just run this code and understand easily, right? Missing data, here we don't have any missing data. General thumb rules. For features with less missing data, you can use a regression to predict the missing value or fill the mean of the values present depending on the feature. For features with high number of missing values, it is better to drop those columns as they give very less insight on analysis. As there's no such thumb rule for on which criteria we should delete these columns with high number of missing values, but generally you can delete the columns. If you have more than 30 to 40% of missing values, but again, there's a catch. For example, I have explained already, right? Let's not go through this. Now, one more thing is you can see that monthly charges is float, total charges is object. And for object category, for object type, when I see that 7043 are non-null values and it's an object, I cannot tell 100% that all the values would be non-null. Okay, so in order to do that, you have to always convert your object values to either float, integer, or to a specific data type, right? So what I will do is I will just convert this object to float object. So here I have just copied the data set so that I keep the base data and I have created a new data set. Here I'm just converting into numeric, or you can say float variable. So once I do this, you can see when I'm using data frame dot is null dot sum, that means how many values are null. Is null is basically used for that. How many values are null? In the first step, what I have done is total charges data frame dot column name equals to PD. PD means pandas, right? Pandas.toNumeric data frame.total charges. Okay. And here I'm doing telco.isNull.sum. Here you can see total charges, 11 values are isNull values. That means 11 records are null values. In the first step, we were not able to identify that. So what I meant to say is, some scenarios you will see that some of the values are object values, object data types. You always have to convert the object into numerical variables or integer or float, and then only you can identify whether you have missing values or not. Okay. As you can see that 11 values are null values. So here what I have done is data frame dot lock data frame total charges is null equals to true. So it will show me the records where the is null, because is null is basically a Boolean object, right? You can just simply go through the Google documentations of pandas. You can easily find that the output of is null is Boolean. Okay. It returns a Boolean object, bool or array. For scalar input, returns a scalar Boolean, right? So that's the reason why I have used, if this is equals to true, that means all those records where we have null values. So these are the 11 records. You can see, if I just scroll down towards the total charges, we have NaN values, right? NaN means basically not a number, right? So missing value treatment, since the percentage of these records compared to the total data set is very low, just 0.5, 15%, 11 records out of 7043 records. How much is it? It's very low, right? In 200, 0.15%, right? That is the reason it is safe to ignore them for further processing. So that's the reason I have dropped those columns. You can also fill it with zero and test it. Okay. I will keep it open for you all. Since the percentage is low, so I have dropped it. So I have used drop NA. So you just have to note down, people who are coming for this ADA class for the very first time, drop NA, fill NA are the important. I will also write down this code, but I will not run it. Okay. What this does is, in this particular data frame, any column which will be having null values or NA values will be filled up with zero. Okay. So I'm just commenting it out here. What I have done is I have dropped it. So drop NA basically means dropping the records. So instead of 7043, now we will have 7032 records, right? How equals to any, in place equals to true. Now dividing these customers. Okay. Now before doing this particular step, I will also explain you some situations why I'm doing this. Now, in this particular use case, I have tenure, right? Now, how to analyze tenure with respect to churned data, churned or not churned? Now, tenure is a specific number, right? 1 till 72 or 80, something like that. Now, if I just plot a graph only for the churners, okay? If I plot a graph, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So there will be 72 records in x-axis, right? So analyzing each one of them might be very hectic. So what we do is, this is my strategy. Okay, what we do is we convert these variables, we convert this particular numerical attribute to a categorical variable, which is called as tenure group. What I do here is 1 to 2 years, 2 to 3 years, 3 to 4 years, 4 above, or maybe 4 to 5 and 5 above. So here we can have a better insight that whether, 0 to 2 years, whether these customers are having at the most churners or these or these or these. Okay. Again, this is up to the developer. It could be 0 to 1, 1 to 2, or it could be 0 to 2, 3 to 5, something like that, right? But the main idea is to create bins, to create groups out of this numerical variable. Okay. If we had specific, if we had these numbers in years instead of months, let's say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, years could maximum be 10 years or 20 years, right? Again, when you have years till 7 or 8, then you can keep it as it is. But you have, let's say you have, even if it is years, you have from 1 to 20. So analyzing these 20 records might be a tedious task. So you can also create bins, 1 to 5, 6 to 10, 11 to 15, and 16 to 20, and 20 plus. Okay, this is one general strategy which you can follow. So in this use case, I have just created bins. Divide the customers into bins based on tenure. For example, tenure less than 12 months, assign a tenure group. Okay, so here I have calculated what is the max value of tenure, and based on that, I have created the bins. Again, tomorrow, if you want to reuse this particular code, you can just have to change these codes. That's it. And you can create your new group. And if you don't have any such column, you can terminate it, right? I'll just run this code. Okay, so all these bins has been created. So 1 year, 2000 records. 2 years, 1024 records, something like that, right? And there are some columns which needs to be removed. When you are dealing with use cases like this, first, your domain knowledge is very important, right? Now, when we are analyzing the data, I have customer ID, gender, geography, tenure, contract type, etc., etc., and churn, right? And I also have customer name. This I have already explained quite a lot of time, but again, customer name, is it important? Let's say my name is Satyajit and I have churned. Somebody's name is Saurav and he has not churned. He's still active in the system. Does that make any sense if I take an insight out of it and create an insight that if my name is Satyajit, I'm likely to churn? This is irrelevant, right? So that is the reason we have to ignore this column. Similarly, customer ID is a randomly generated number. People who are working in real industries and in the IT industries or any industries, they know, right? Some kind of IDs that are assigned to any customers that are automatically generated. They don't play any major role, right? They don't have any statistical importance. That is the reason we are also ignoring the customer IDs, right? Similarly, in this use case, I have ignored customer ID and tenure because I don't need my tenure because I already have tenure group, right? So let me run this. This is how the new data looks like. Gender, this, right? I have removed the tenure column and this is the new column which I have created, tenure group. Okay, everybody clear with this step? Our next step is going to be, that's where the fun begins. Exploratory data analysis starts from here. Okay. So here what I have done is, simple thing is, I have just created a predictor. Here I have used Seaborn library to find the count plot. Now this will give me the counts of churners with respect to each and every column. Here I'm just passing the data and I have my predictor and I have my US churn. Okay. So when I do this, in this particular data, all the columns, the distribution will be shown here. You can see gender, churners and non-churners. This is the ratio of female, male for senior citizen. Now you can see this one, female 2500, male is also almost 2600, right? So the ratio is almost similar, very close to 50%. That means gender is not a important feature standalone, but when it is combined to other features, it could be an important feature, right? When it comes to churners and non-churners, almost female and male, almost similar to each other. So that's the reason I told gender is not an important feature standalone. Coming on to senior citizen. Zero means non-senior citizen. One means senior citizen. You can see we have more non-senior citizens, right? But the ratio of churners in senior citizen is very high. You can see, let's say this number is arbitrarily speaking, it's 700. This is somewhere around 500. So the ratio is almost 40% as compared to the original ratio, which is 27%. Here I can see if a customer is senior citizen, he is more likely to churn, right? The next one, partner. Again, you can see churner ratio is high when the candidate is single. They don't have a partner, right? He's more likely to churn. Not sure about the exact reason, but it's funny, right? If somebody is not having a partner, he is more likely to churn. Okay. These are some of the insights which we are getting from the univariate analysis. The univariate analysis, right? Dependence. You can see. Dependence, yes. Obviously, it is very contradictory. I would say partner and dependents are negatively correlated, right? Because if you have partners, you don't have dependents. If you have dependents, you don't have partners, right? So dependents, yes. Now, dependents could be spouse as well, right? So that's the reason I told negatively correlated. But yeah, dependents also means your parents, right? So when you have dependents, you are less likely to churn. You can see the ratio. Don't know the exact numbers. 1800 is to 400. Very less ratio. But when it comes to no dependents, they are high churners, right? Similarly, phone service. You can see, again, I would say that people with phone service are more likely to churn, right? All these insights could be taken. You can go through each and every graph and understand. This is how your univariate analysis is done, right? Now you can see electronic check. So this is one of the univariate insights which we can get. Payment method, electronic check. You can see highest churners who are going for electronic check. Credit card, lowest churners. Could be a reason that they could be having an auto debit feature or something like that. Could be multiple reasons, right? So electronic check is one of the important feature here which we got. So again, you can go through all these graphs and you can understand which is likely to be an important feature, which is not likely to be an important feature, right? Now what we are doing is converting the target variable churn to a binary numerical variable, so into zeros and ones. So yes means ones, that means he's churned. No means he's not churned. Okay, let me run this. This is how the data set looks like. Now converting all the categorical variables into dummy variables. So this is one of the important topics. Before running this code, I will explain you how to convert categorical variables into numerical variables. Very important topic in exploratory data analysis topic, right? When we have categorical variables, let's say gender, male, female, and we also have a third category, transgender, right? And let's say one more feature is geography, Spain, Germany, and something else, Florida. Just one example. Now, obviously, if I cannot feed the categorical data to the computers, right? Because ultimately the computers will understand the numerical variables, right? Which is quite a basic concept which we already know, right? So in order to convert the categorical data to numerical data, there are different techniques which we need to do. Label encoding is one of the topics, and one-hot encoding. Okay. Now, what is label encoding? Label encoding is very similar to a normal replace command. Now, if you replace these values, male as 1, female as 2, and transgender as 3. So in this particular example, I don't have this category, so I'm just removing it for a better understanding. So here, if you do male as 1 and female as 0, no offense, you can also do this way, nothing to worry about, right? Let's say male is 1 and female is 0. Similarly, if we have geography, there could be 10 variables here, right? So Spain, Germany, Florida, Mumbai, something like that. Now, if I just arbitrarily mark it as 1, 2, 3, 4, and just feed the data to the model, there are high chances that model will give high priority to this particular attribute, then second priority to this, third priority to this, fourth priority to this. Because ultimately, models understand numbers, right? So if you feed arbitrary values, arbitrary numbers to the models, it might be misleading for the models. Models might wrongly interpret, right? That is the reason why we cannot do this. So this is one of the techniques which is called as label encoding. Encoding based on the labels 1, 2, 3, 4. Label encoding is only meant to be used for target variables, your Y variables. You should only do label encoding for target variables. Now let's jump into one-hot encoding. How to solve this problem? If I pass 1, 2, 3, 4, obviously it's a problematic situation, right? To the models. Model will misinterpret. It will, as it is having a higher value, it will consider this as the most important feature or something like that, right? Okay, somebody has any questions? Or if we have many missing values like over 75%, should we remove that row? Okay, row-wise? No, row-wise, you should always do an analysis based on column-wise. Column-wise analysis is required, right? Because columns are your features. Okay, now, let's jump into this topic. 1, 2, 3, 4 is not a right solution to this. Okay, so what is the solution to this? There is a concept called as one-hot encoding. Very interesting topic. So what we do is, instead of geography, let's say I have geography like this. So this is my original column, right? Geography. So what I will do is I will create, let's consider I have four columns, right? 1, 2, 3, and 4. What I will create is, I will create, let me draw it again, Spain. Okay, it's better to explain in Google Sheets. Okay, let's say I have faster for me as well. I have geography, and let's say Spain, Germany, Florida, Mumbai, Spain. Okay, and there are multiple attributes, gender, and there are contract type, and there are X1, okay, some other attributes as well, which we don't care about, male, female, 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 okay, something like this. Now, what we need to do is, we have to convert this particular attribute. Instead of 1, 2, 3, the traditional method is converting 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 1, 1, 2, right? Obviously, this is not the right way. That's the reason I told label encoding is not the right solution for this. Instead of this, what we need to do is we need to create one-hot encoding. So what we need to do is we will create a new column. It's geography Spain. Let me write it as Geo Spain. Geo Germany, Geo Florida, Geo Mumbai. Now I will assign values here. Let's say Spain 1, 0, 0, 0, Germany 1, Florida 1, Mumbai 1, Spain 1, 1, 1, 1. So 1. Okay, so we are filling the values with respect to zeros and ones, which is a better format, better understandable by computers. 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. Okay, so this is how we convert the categorical variables into this. This concept is basically called as one-hot encoding. Again, there is one more concept called as dummy trap. Okay. Now what happens is, there is a concept called as dummy trap. I will not go through that in depth. You can just Google it out. You will get the information. Dummy trap basically means that now, instead of using four variables, these are four new attributes which will be used in the model, right? And obviously your model will become a little bit computationally more expensive, because as compared to one column, now you have four columns, right? Four features. Now, what is dummy trap? This is the four different columns that I have created from the geography, because we have four different valid values. If you have 10 valid values, you will have 10 columns like this. Now, what I can do is, what if I strike down this particular column? That means I'm going to ignore this column. Now, if I already have Spain as one, which basically means Mumbai will be zero, right? Which is very obvious. Now, if I have given these three fields, can I have this particular field or not? The answer is yes, right? Because if all the values are zero, this will be one. If you find one here, it will be zero, right? So that is the reason. What happens is, when you are doing one-hot encoding, you are creating multiple variables. Let's say you are creating n variables. It is recommended to use n minus one variables in the model. Okay, you can use n variables as well. Not a problem. But this is basically the term called as dummy trap. Okay, so we have to ignore one dummy variable. So before this, let's say our function is y equals to m1 x1 plus m2 x2 plus c. Instead of this, let's say this is my categorical variable. So this will be changed to m1 x1 plus let's say m1 d1 plus m2 d2. This is small m, guys, just plus m3 d3 plus m4 d4 plus c. Okay, this is how the formula changes, and you can easily remove this. That's the main idea. So your computer will not be, your model will not be. So anybody has any doubts? Okay, nobody. Okay, so this is one-hot encoding. You can also perform one-hot encoding yourself, but apart from that, there is also one more library, one more functionality of pandas. That's basically getDummies. Okay, now getDummies also does the same thing. Female, male, one zeros. Paper, no, one zeros. Okay, it converts into zeros and ones, right? So I'll just run this particular code. I haven't ignored the dummy trap here. So I have used all the variables, but you can do it yourself. You can also remove these variables. As I told you, you can remove one variables. You can also remove gender male. You can remove partner. Yes, so your number of features will be decreased. But in this particular model, I'm using everything, and we will see how the model behaves. Okay, based on that, we will remove it. Next, what I'm doing is I'm seeing a relationship between monthly charges and total charges. Now you can see I'm using a LM plot. Total charges increases as monthly charges increases, which is as expected, right? Because monthly charges is the monthly charges. Total charges could be your annual charges, or let's say you are in the system for 5 months, your monthly charges are 100, so your total charges will be 500, right? That's the same example which I took. So your monthly charges and total charges are highly correlated. Okay, so your correlation value will be very high, so which is very much visible in this particular code. This is one of the codes which I have done for churning by monthly charges and total charges. You can see this particular piece of code. Churn is high and when monthly charges are high. You can see whenever the monthly charges are high, your churn is high, right? You can or you cannot. You don't have to worry about it. This is just an extra thing which I have done. Total charges. You can see this is a surprising insight as high churn at lower total charges. However, if we combine the insights of three parameters, that is tenure, monthly charges and total charges, then the picture is a bit clear. Higher monthly charge at lower tenure results into lower total charge. Hence, all these factors, higher monthly charge, lower tenure and lower total charge, are linked to high churn, right? That's the reason I told you have to do univariate, multivariate. A lot of analysis is required, then only you will get insights. You will not get insights only from univariate analysis. Okay. So this is also one of the correlation which I have done from all the predictors. I will just run it. You can see this is the zero scale and this is the positive scale and this is the negative scale. That means which predictors are more likely to be giving more insights for the churning thing. You can see this is little bit not quite visible, but at least you can see contract month to month. 40% churners, 40%. It's not like 40% churners. It's like 0.4 probabilistic score. You can call it as correlation score or something like that. Okay. So these are the, you can say these are the features which are more important. Contract monthly, online security, no, tech support, no. Could be multiple reasons, right? Because they don't have tech support or they don't have online security. So they are churning. Could be of multiple reasons. And you can see here contract 2 year is having the lowest value. That means when you have 2 years contract, then you are very less likely to churn. So these are some of the derived insight. The derived insights are high churn seen in case of month to month customers, month to month contracts, no online security, no tech support, first year of subscription, and fiber optics internet. Low churn is seen in cases of long-term contracts, subscriptions without internet service, and the customers engaged for 5+ years. I think, yeah, you can see tenure. Tenure 61 to 72 is also here. That means they are also very less churners because they are very old customers and they fall into which category? Conditional loyal category, right? So they are very much loyal to this particular telecom company. So they are not churning. So this is one of the heat maps which I have created. Somebody told me, right, how to create correlation function, dataframe.core. CORR function gives you the idea about the correlation. You can just simply Google it. What is core? Core is basically calculates a matrix R of correlation coefficients. Okay. In depth, you can go through the correlation coefficients to understand better, but that's the main idea, like -1 to 1. It will range from -1 to 1. You can see that, let's say how monthly charges are from these insights, let's say contract month to month. Where is contract month to month? Contract month to month. How contract month to month is related to some other variables. Contract month to month, you can see this is the self one. Now this basically explains you how the relationship happens. You can analyze each and every column. Senior citizen with respect to monthly charges, with respect to total charges, with respect to churn, all these things, right? Now contract month to month with respect to churn, you can see a pinkish value, right? Now, if you see the labels, pink comes somewhere around here, right? Oh, sorry. Contract 2 year is having the pinkish value. Sorry, my bad. Contract 2 year is having this pinkish value. You can see this where my cursor is. Okay. If I just copy this image into a paintbrush, that will be easier. Okay. No, it's not easier. It's okay. You got my point, right? 2 years, you can see this pinkish value. That's the reason you can understand that it's having a negative correlation value. Contract month to month, you can see the shade is somewhere like this, okay? So this is the shade, somewhere around 0.4, 0.5. That means they are very much correlated to each other. When your tenure, when your churn values increases, your contract month to month increases and vice versa. So this heat map basically helps for numerical analysis. Okay. Now let's move into the bivariate analysis. So what I have done is I have just simply, as I told you, bivariate analysis means analyzing two variables. Okay. So what I have done is I have created two new data frames. One data frame is for churners, one data frame is for non-churners. And we are more concerned about the churners, right? So that means we are more concerned about the new underscore df1 underscore target1. So these are the churners. Okay. So here what I've created is I have created a function. I have created a uniplot. And let's just call this uniplot. So here I'm passing my data frame, which is my churners data frame. Column, which column do you want? Title, I have provided distribution of gender for churned customers. Hue, I have provided as gender. Okay. If I run this, this is the output. Let me zoom out a little bit. Okay. So this is the output. This is for churners. You can see partner, yes, partner, like who have more partners, they are having more, they're churning more as compared to no, right? Now when it, sorry, so when it comes to females, there are, in this particular category, in yes category, it's almost 50-50, but partner no, males are more likely to churn. Okay. Similarly, you can do this for multiple attributes. You just have to call this uniplot function, change your, I just have to run this code. Okay, my code was not run, okay. So you can see for, you got my point, right? For partner, sorry, so that was the wrong, okay, we were, this is not, oh, this is for non-churners. This is for non-churners. So this particular graph is for churners. You can see no partners means more churners, right? So out of them, male is to female ratio is almost similar. So not much of insights from this particular bivariate data. Again, in yes also, not much of relevant information, but you can say that with yes partners, like with people with yes, male are more into churning. So target zero also, I have plotted it, but it's not important as I told you. Okay, let's go through the payment method. Payment method, if I just scroll above to the univariate part, we already had quite good amount of information, right? That electronic check are the highest churners as compared to other categories, mail check or credit card and all those things. Electronic check are the highest churners. Now, what do we get from the bivariate analysis? Again, electronic check are high churners, which is quite okay, which is known, right? We know this. But what is the distribution between male and female? Almost similar. So not much of insights. But here you can see some more insights. Even though the credit card, the payment method credit card automatic is the lowest category here, but you can see female are the most churners. So most female users using credit card are the more churners. You can also target this. This is also a very good insight which we have got, right? Similarly, you can also do it with other categories, contract. Let's say contract, let's go through contract. Monthly contracts, almost similar ratio, but yeah, we know that monthly contract are more churners, right? Let's go to tech support. Again, tech support, very distributed gender. You can see male, female, almost 50-50 ratio, not much of insights. Senior citizen, again, almost distributed. We know that zero senior citizen are more churners, right? So these are the insights which you can get. I have just arbitrarily picked the columns. You can do it for all the columns and you can get it. So this is the conclusion which I have got from this particular ADA which I have done. Okay, these are some of the quick insights. Electronic check, mediums are the highest churners. Okay, contract type, monthly customers are more likely to churn because of no contract terms, as they are free to go customers. No online security, no tech support category are high churners. Non-senior citizens are high churners, right? There could be many more such insights. So take this as an assignment and try to get more insights. And the final dummies data, I have just converted into the CSV file so that I can use this particular data frame I can use this particular data set for my model building part. So that's it for ADA. We will take a 5 minutes break. My throat is also drying up. You can also take a 5 minutes break and we will quickly be back. Okay, so let's be back in 5 minutes for the model building part. Okay. I'm back, but as we have already given 5 minutes break, so let's wait for 2 more minutes. So I'm just switching the slides to the model building part. I have just opened the model building part. Any doubts? Aishwarya is telling that there's some little confusion with churn, like customer leaving, customer hopping to another services, but same platform. No, that could be multiple reasons. This particular use case is all about which are the target customers who are going to churn, right? Within the systems, we are not analyzing at the moment. Within the systems, there would be more data which is required, like more data, like detailed usage data and all those things. So that kind of data is not available here, right? Usage, monthly usage, what is the bandwidth, night calls, internet usage, all this information is not present here. So that is the reason we are not doing that within the system churning. We are not doing that. We are just considered about which are the probable customers who are going to leave the company forever, leave the services. Okay, let's move ahead with the model building part, which is one of the most important topic in this particular session. EDA part, I hope everybody is clear with this, but I am pretty much sure once you get the code, once you start running this code, you will have a better understanding and you will definitely, you know, have a better insight, you know, how to understand. You will have a better understanding on the EDA part, right? So let's move ahead with the churn prediction model part. In this EDA, as you can see, I have already saved this file to this particular tell churn CSV. So I'll be using that. Before that, I already have the list of libraries that I have. Yeah, it depends actually. So let me talk to you in separately after this particular session, because that's a very complex situation which you have asked. Would not be very much, it will be very difficult for me to understand, for me to explain to everyone, right? So I'll talk to you personally for that. Okay, there are different techniques where you can easily deal with these particular scenarios where you have more than 150, 200 features, which is quite possible in banking and financial sector, right? So I'll talk about that. Okay, so let's talk about this. I have already imported the libraries. Let me just close it. So let's read the data frame. .csv. Okay, this is how the data frame looks like. Unnamed zero. So okay, unnamed, I think somehow this field has been appended in the file. So we can delete it. So df equals to df.drop unnamed colon zero, colon space zero, I think. Okay, so from access equals to one. Okay, so now if I do ahead, so this is how the data frame looks like. Monthly charges, total charges, churn, gender, female, all these things I have. Okay, denier and all those things I have, right? So the next thing is creating my X and Y variable, creating X and Y variables. Now X is nothing but independent variable and Y is nothing but my dependent variable, which is my churn variable, right? This particular field, where is churn? This is my Y variable, right? So I'll create my X variable, X equals to df.drop. I'll drop the churn variable from access equals to one, right? And let's print X. So this is how X looks like. Simple X, right? Similarly, I will create my Y variable. Y equals to df of churn. Okay, so this is my Y variable. Everybody clear with this step? I have just differentiated our data into X and Y, right? So I have my X variable where I have multiple features and I have my Y variable. So basically, yeah, I think you have missed the initial slides which I talked about. The initial slides will explain you about what exactly customer retention is and all those things, because there are different strategies which needs to be followed based on the category of customers we are identifying. So what we identify is customers are leaving the company or not, right? But what is the different segment of those customers? That is more important. So apart from this model, you will also have to do some segmentation and all those things, which is, I can also cover a session on that in the next session, not possible in this part. But these are the strategies. Our main goal is to identify the segments of the customers. Only then you can identify what needs to be done. If you know that two customers are churning and one customer is churning because of this reason, one customer is churning because of this reason. Let's say customer one is having service issues. Customer two is having plan related issues. So you can act accordingly, right? To act, data scientists does not take part in the decision making part. Along with data scientists, there are sales team, pre-sales team, and higher management who helps in the decision making process in order to try to give them some offers and try to build some strategies in order to retain them, right? Let's move into the use case. So X and Y variables are clear. Now our next step is going to be bifurcating the data into training and test data. So X train, X test, Y train, Y test. Test size equals to 0.2. So what I'm doing is I'm converting the data into training and test data. That means if I have 8,000 records, or let's say I have 10,000 records, test size equals to 0.2 means 2,000 records are test data and 8,000 records are training data, right? So I will train the model with 8,000 records, and on top of that model, I will see what is the accuracy on the test data, and then I can compare. Because test data, I already have the data, I will use it for comparing, and that's where I can take the final decision that, okay, this model is working fine or not. And that model can be used for unseen data later on, right? Again, there is no thumb rule for this particular thing, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4. It all depends how much percentage are you using. Now, here I will call my decision tree. So, decision tree classifier. So, here I'm using decision trees. Again, if I start explaining about each and every algorithm, it will take me ages to finish. So there are a lot of classifiers, like logistic classifiers, nav-based classifiers, bagged classifiers, ensemble techniques. There are a lot of techniques where you can use and create a classifier, right? So for this particular use case, I'm using decision trees. No specific reasons for that. So what I will call is, I have already imported decision tree. Okay, so I'll just call model equals to decision tree classifier. Now you can keep it open, or else you can pass some parameters as well. Now, which parameters to pass? How will we know? Simple, just have to go to the documentation part. Decision tree classifier, sklearn. You will see that these are the parameters which needs to be passed. Criterion, splitter, and a lot of things are already mentioned. So there are two different criterions based on which a decision trees are created. Okay, one of them is Gini index and one of them is entropy based. I will try to cover that in one of my videos, but yeah, for the time being, I'm just using Gini. Random state and what else? Random state, max depth, whatever. If you are not providing anything, it will use the default values. If you provide anything based on that, it will use the values which you are using in the model. Okay. So I'll just use random state equals to 100, and let's use some parameters. Let's say max depth. Max depth means how depth your tree will be. Okay. People who are new to machine learning and all those things, they can just criterion. Okay. Min leaves, leaf, min samples. Okay. So the decision tree classifier is called. Now, once you call the decision tree classifier, then what you need to do is you need to fit the data. You have to fit your training data, right? So you have to fit the data. So what we can do is we can create, I will call my model, which is already created in line number 14, model dot fit. So what I will fit? I will fit the training data, xtrain and ytrain. So run this. So you can see your model is created, decision tree classifier on max depth, this means. So again, we don't know that these are the final values or not. There are different steps called as hyperparameter optimization. You can also use those steps to identify which is the best value. Okay, I will share the code of hyperparameter optimization, but it's not included in this particular session. Okay, so decision tree classifier is created. Now what's next? Let's create a prediction variable ypred equals to, I will call my model, I will call the xtest. So my ypred is created. Let's print it. Okay, ypred is created. And I already have my ytest, right? I'm just removing it. So ypred is created. What's next? We need to compare the predicted y value with the actual y value, right? With the actual test y value. So what's next? So there is something called as model.score. Xtest and ypred. Something is wrong. 100% accuracy, no. 1 second. Let me call the classification report. Y test and ypred labels equals to 01. Something is wrong. let's forget about this okay. thing. Let's print the classification report. Oh, something is wrong. Classification report. Y test labels. Model equal to decision tree classifier. Criterion, everything looks to be fine. Random state 100, max step 6, min leaves 8. Model dot fit. Extreme white red. White pad. Text. Model dot score. White test, white thread. Something is wrong. Let's print the accuracy or let's print the confusion matrix. Okay. Now this is fine. Oh, sorry. 01. My bad. Now you can see. So I had just mistyped it as 0.1. Okay. Now you can see that for class 0, that means my non-churners, my precision is 84%, recall is 87%, and F1 score is 86%. Now again, if somebody has any doubts on precision, recall, and F1 score, let me just open one slide so that I can quickly explain. Because without this, you will not be able to understand. Okay, let's just open Google itself. Let's take some example, where, some good examples. Okay. No good examples are there. But yeah, you can see that. Let me open. Just give me 1 second. But how can you, Gora, how can you get tribal company subscriber database? It's unethical, right? You don't have rights to do that. Why will those companies give you the details about their internal customers? Okay, so yeah, this is one of the examples where you can easily understand. Okay, now what is this? You can see that confusion matrix is basically actual versus predicted. Okay, now actual 0 and predicted 0. Now actual 1 and predicted 1 is basically called as true positives. That means they are correctly predicted as 1 and they are actually 1. So they are called as true positives. Actual 1 and predicted as 0 are basically called as false negatives. Okay, similarly, actual 0 and predicted 0 is called as true negatives. That means they are correctly predicted as negatives. Actual 0 and predicted 1 is basically false positive. You can see this particular scenario. Actual 1 and predicted 1, that means the doctor is telling that you are pregnant and the lady is actually pregnant, right? Actual 0 and predicted 1, the doctor is telling you are pregnant and it's a type 1 error because he's a man, right? He cannot be pregnant, right? This is a scenario of false positives. So your model ultimately has to deal with these two type of errors. And you have to aim to decrease these two type of errors, right? What is false negative? Actually, it is pregnant. The lady is pregnant, but doctor is telling that you are not pregnant. So it is predicted as 0. Actually, it is 1, right? True negatives, it is telling that you are not pregnant and obviously it is not pregnant. So your accuracy is basically this particular area, true positives plus true negatives divided by total outcome. This is your accuracy. So ultimately, your main aim is to reduce false positives and false negatives. False positives are called as type 1 error and false negatives are type 2 error. Recall is nothing but true positives by true positives plus false negative. precision is true positive divided by true positive plus false positive. Okay, so these are the formulas. You can go through it later on. I will not take a session on that part. Okay, so it is termed that when you are dealing with these particular problem statements, okay, you always look at the minority class. Okay, always look at the minority class. Here our minority class is Chirners, right? One. Here you can see the precision, recall and F1 score is very low. That means the model is not properly created. Why? Because it's an imbalanced dataset problem. I already told you, right? Imbalanced dataset problem, your accuracy will not be very high. Your recall precision will be very low, right? Even if my accuracy is good, you can see the accuracy. 919 plus 177 divided by this. Almost 75% accuracy. But no point in creating this model, right? I can simply, without this machine learning model, if I simply create a model with a print statement, any input, print it as a non-churner. Still, I will have 73% accuracy, right? That is the reason accuracy is termed as cursed. Okay, let's move ahead. How to deal with this problem? So to deal with this problem, that's the reason we will use SMART analysis. SMART analysis is used for dealing with these kind of problems, which internally does your upsampling and downsampling. So I'll be using SMART ENN. You can just quickly go through this particular library, what it does. This is a class to perform oversampling using SMART and cleaning using ENN. So just consider it as an upsampling and downsampling technique. Okay. So let's create. So I have already imported my SMART library, imblearn.combine. In case you don't have that, you have to pip install imblearn. So something equals to SMART ENN. And then I will create a resampled version, y resampled. I thought to finish everything in 2 hours, but it has already been 2 hours, 9 minutes. It's not yet finished. So let's quickly wrap it up. So I have called this. On top of this, what's next? Very similarly, I have to call all these functions. Okay. I will just name it as xtrain, xrtrain, maybe something, xrtrain, xrtest, ohrtrain, ohrtest. Test spread x underscore resampled. I should have written the code. Okay, run this code. Same copy paste, create your model again. Model underscore dt, instead of that, we will create model underscore dt underscore smart. Same decision tree I'm calling, and again, I will call the same fit function after this. What I need to fit, this model dot fit, which data? Training data, right? So what is my training data? XR train and YR train. Okay, the model is fitted. Then I will do a prediction. So Y pred mu or Y pred smart equals to model dot predict, which data? XR underscore test. Okay. I'm creating new variables so that it is understandable. We will not reuse the old variables so that we can easily call them and see what is the values later on, right? So similarly, I will call my classification report on y test. So what is my y test? YR test. And what is my predicted value? Y pred. So let's call this. Now you can see with respect to this model, 84%, sorry, for class 0 it's still good, for class 1 0.57, 0.5, 0.53, you can see the data now. 93% precision, 95% recall and 94% F1 score. This means this model is really good, right? So this is one of the insights, that this model is really good. Now you would say that how about different classifiers, because when it comes to hands-on coding part, you don't have to build just one particular model and finalize it, right? There are tons and tons of classifiers, and you can easily create tons and tons of classifiers and then evaluate your model accordingly. Okay, So what we need to do is, instead of decision trees, let's try to create a random forest classifier. Same piece of code I will reuse. Okay. Accuracy we are not using here because accuracy is cursed, right? So that's the reason I'm just printing the classification thing, and I can also print the confusion matrix. Let's print the confusion matrix, wire test and y pred. See, very good results, right? Very good results. You can see the accuracy here. Now you can consider the accuracy because it's a balanced data set right now, because we have performed the SMART analysis. 1098 divided by 1098 plus, okay, let's do this way, plus 1098 1180 92% accuracy. Okay, let's try to create a random forest classifier. Again, I'm not calling the basic classifier, okay, because again the basic classifier, okay, let's call it. It will not take much time. Let me write down the code and then I will change it. Let me do it in a, sorry. Shoot. Okay, predict function. Okay, so what I've done is I have created a random forest classifier. In order to do that, I have to import the libraries from sklearn.ensemble import random forest classifier. Okay, random forest classifier. Now, what are the different parameters? Again, you have to go through the codes and do it, right? So there is something called as n estimators. And let's use the same parameters. Just add n estimators. Now n estimators is nothing but the number of trees, because random forest internally uses decision trees. Okay, so again, I will not be able to cover it in depth what exactly is random forest. Just consider it as one more classification model, right? So n estimators, let's rename it to model rf. Okay, and everything is fine. ypred_rf. Okay, random forest is not defined. Okay, now you can see very similar to this thing, very low precision recall for the minority class. Similarly, in random forest, also very low precision recall. However, the precision is better. But now, what is Gini and what is entropy? It's again, it's a very good, very, very prolonged debate which will happen, because yeah, these are the two different ways how you can create your decision trees. Okay, Gini index and entropy. These are two different techniques how your decision trees are created. How you finalize that, who is going to be the root node, which is the most important feature and all those things. Okay. Random forest. Right? See, now we will quickly create the smart part for random forest and see if we are able to get better results or not. Just copy paste and we will be able to find the solution of this. Wait. Okay. Okay. So let me rename it resampled RF, Y resampled RF. Okay, anyways, it's same, right? So XR test, it's going to be same. Let's not call it. Here, I will call my random forest. Here, model smart underscore RF. Okay, so I'm just calling it smart function XT. Random forest model.fit ypred smart underscore rf Just changing the variables, that's it. Smart underscore RF, okay. Fit, predict, classification report, see. 93, 97, 95. 93, 95, 94. So this is better as compared to that one. So now let's see what will be the confusion matrix. Okay, let's consider what will be the total value here. 468 plus 49 plus 22 plus 621. 1160 values, right? 1160 values. 468 plus 621 divided by 1160. 93.879%. 93.87% accuracy. Now what is here? 481 plus 49 plus, obviously the values will be same. 1180 or 1160. 468 plus 49 plus 22 plus 621. Okay. Why it has been changed? Test data. Okay, let's see. So here the accuracy is 481 plus 617 divided by 1160. Oh, my mistake. 481 plus 617 divided by 1180. 93. So almost 93-94%, almost very similar kind of outputs in both the models, right? Similarly, you have to try for other models. There are a lot of models called as there are a lot of ensemble techniques, but before that, there are a lot of standalone models, logistic functions, SVMs, decision trees, naive-based classifiers, KNN classifiers. There are a lot of things, and there are a lot of ensemble techniques as well. Band classifiers, extra tree classifiers, and in boosting also, there are a lot of IDA boost, XG boost, a lot of concepts are there, right? So you have to try different models. But then only you can come to a conclusion which model is going to be useful. Okay, so our random forest, let's move it. So what's next? Our next step is going to be saving the model. So this model is particularly you already created, model underscore smart underscore RF. Okay, we can simply call this code and also make an API, but it's always recommended to save your models so that you can reuse it later. Now tomorrow, if you shut down your code and if you tomorrow come back and you want to reuse the model, you don't have time to rebuild everything, right? Because this is a very generic use case and a very small data set, so your training time will not be more than 15 minutes and you can easily run it. But think about real scenarios where you have data in GBs, where your model is taking more than 10 hours, 15 hours, 20 hours to run. See, in those scenarios, you cannot afford time, right? You cannot rerun your models again and again and again. So it's a wise practice to always save your models so that in future you can just call the models and call your predict function on your unseen data, right? So our next topic is saving the model. So in order to know how to save the model, there is a concept of pickle. Okay, now what is pickle? You can just simple Google it. Pickle is nothing but we save our pickles, right? It's based on the same concept only. We have to save our models. No, SmartNN is not restricted to decision tree. SmartNN is a generic concern, generic concept to deal with upsampling and downsampling techniques. You can also reuse resample. There is something called as resample. Okay. Sklearn resample. You can also use this in order to deal with this particular problem, imbalanced dataset problem. Okay. SmartNN just it's just one of the techniques to use it. Okay, so let's go ahead and use our pickle file. Sorry, you save our model. So I will name our file as, let's say, model.sav. And here pickle.dump. What I need to dump? I need to dump my model, right? So this is the model that I have created. I will dump it. you can save multiple models in your multiple files, and you can also call your pickle files and then reuse it as well. Nothing to worry about. Now, where to save? Open file name in write mode. Okay, so I'm dumping it. So our dumping has been done. If you can see, the model.csv is already created in my this particular folder where I have the file where I'm currently working in, right? You can see date modified model.sav is already saved, 1455. So my local time is 2:55 right now, so it's already saved. Okay, now how to call the model and how to see whether the model is perfectly done or not, or whether the model is correct or not, what's inside the model and all those things. So you can load the model. Load model equals to pickle.load, open file name, open in read mode. RB is read mode, W is write mode. Okay, something is wrong. Load model, pickle.load, open file name. What is wrong here? What is wrong? Pickle.load, open. Okay, my bad. Open file name in write mode. Okay, so our model is loaded here. Now, loaded model, let's see what is the score. Let's say I will pass my XR test data. Sorry, what is XR test? And what is my wire test? Okay. So the score is 93.87%. That means it is having 93.87% of accuracy. Okay. You can also send one particular data frame or one particular record in this model and call your predict function also. But it's just for testing purpose, right? Now our next topic is going to be deployment. How to deploy this code? This is the code which I have developed. How to deploy it? Obviously, I don't need all these pieces of code, right? Because I have already saved my model. So ultimately, what we need to do is, it's a generic concept. I will explain you how to deploy a normal code. People coming from programming background might already be knowing it, but what we created is a Python code, right? How will it be accessible to UI team or to some UI portal or front end? How will it be accessible? If I convert this code into APIs, it will be accessible, right? Again, I will not go in depth and explain you what is an API and all those things, but the generic concept is that to make a backend code, you know, expose your backend code, you have to create APIs, okay? And you expose your APIs. For example, let's say I will create a predict function, and I will, this is an API, I will create it as a post API, and I will expose it. Whatever I am doing here, if somebody is calling the predict function from the front end, what it will do is the call will come to the backend code, it will hit, and it will take you the input and show you the output, right? Even whatever it is returning here, I'm returning something, return XYZ. If I will return like this XYZ, your output will be XYZ, right? The main idea is clear, right? Flask for web apps and Docker for GCP, yeah, correct. So the main idea is clear. Input is fetched from UI. Something is done here. Output is transferred to the UI, okay? And you can, in the meanwhile, you can also save this code to your, or save this output to your database. That is secondary. Okay, you can do that. So in order to do that, we use Flask. Flask, what is Flask? I will talk about what is Flask in brief, because again, I have a Flask deployment video in my YouTube playlist. You can easily go through Flask. Let me show you the video so that you can go through later on. Sorry about my feed. You could see a lot of crime patrol videos. I usually watch them. Okay. I will share. I think it's already shared in the same video itself, which is going on live right now. I think it's already shared. I'm not sure. Let me show. Okay, it's already shared. You can see this particular thing, machine learning deployments. It has everything. How to deploy it in, how to create your first Flask application in detail, I have explained. On top of that, how to deploy it in GCP, how to deploy it in AWS, and all those things are present. Okay. Okay, let's come back to the problem statement. Okay, I was going to explain you what is Flask. In details, you can go through that video, but yeah, just generic inputs I will explain. Flask is nothing but it's a web framework. Okay, web framework. Flask provides user with tools, libraries, and technologies to allow to build a web application. There is a concept called as WSGI, which is nothing known as, which is nothing but Web Server Gateway Interface, WSGI. Okay. There is a concept of Flask URL binding. Flask URL binding. Now, what is URL binding? That means it is used to build a URL to specify specific functions dynamically. Okay. So Flask HTTP methods, basic HTTP methods, everybody might be knowing it. If not, nothing to worry about. I can simply go through them. Some of the post, some of the HTTP methods are post, get, delete. Okay. These are the basic functionalities which we should know, right? Head and all those things. What is post? Post is something you send something to the server and you are expecting something. Get is like you are just sending information, right? Get is sending data in unencrypted form to the server. Post is send form data to the server and getting some feedback or getting some output. Okay. So in this particular session, what we are trying to do is the same piece of code. We have created a code. We are going to convert it into Flask APIs so that using those APIs, we can access this from our front end. Okay, in real scenarios, we use Flask, we use some different other techniques as well. But okay, so Flask is very easy to understand so that you can understand, okay, this is how a machine learning code is deployed. Okay, so I have already created the model and Flask code I already have written, okay. Again, if you want to understand each and every code, you can go through that particular video to understand. Okay, so what I have done here is, I will just quickly walk through. Here, I have created all the import libraries. Very similar, very easy, right? Very easy to understand. I have created my Flask application. You can ignore this particular thing. This is very specific to this code. Here, this is the load page. That means which page to load first. App.route is nothing but which location it should route to. Slash something means the home page itself. If I provide it as slash predict, it will be home page slash predict. Right? That's how it works. Okay. So when we are calling the load page, it is returning a render template home.html. So what it is doing is it is going to this particular templates folder and opening this home HTML file. And this is how the home HTML file looks like. Senior citizen, monthly charges, and all those things. Okay, there are a lot of things. These are the inputs and these are the outputs. Okay, this is the whole HTML file which we have created. Okay, if you just want to see the HTML file, this is how it looks like. Looks complicated, but it is very easy, okay. You can go through that Flask video. It will be very easy for you to follow. It's nothing but I have just copy pasted the queries. That's it. 19 queries I have and 2 outputs. Okay. Okay, everything is done. So here what we have done is I have 19 concrete inputs. Okay. That means concrete values. Out of 19, I have created some one-hot encoding, right? Or I have created my get dummies. And I have created 50 or 51 columns, right? But as an input, I will be expecting the concrete values. So what I have done is I have created 19 inputs. Instead of this, you can also create another technique would be, instead of this one, you can also give you can also give a upload button, that upload a CSV, and in that CSV your customer attributes will be there, and based on that also you can predict, okay, for this customer what is the prediction. Or but this is the best way to understand as you are doing it for the first time. Okay, so I have defined 19 different input queries. I'll just remove this code. Here I am loading the data, loading the model, model.sav. Okay. Data equals to input query 1, input query 2, blah, blah, blah. Here I have defined the column names. These are the column names. I have done some concatenation here. Here I have just created a tenure group because tenure is the input thing, right? Tenure group I have created. And you can go through these columns, go through this code, it's going to be very easy to understand, okay. And then what I have done is, if I have called the predict function on the new data frame. Now, so basically the idea is, input is coming from the UI, that input is converted to a data frame. Obviously the data frame will have one record, right? So on that one record, I'm doing a prediction, and I'm doing a prediction underscore probab. Predict underscore probab basically gives you a probabilistic output. If it is 0 or 1, your output will be either 0 or 1. But when you are using predict underscore probab, your output will be in an array. Let's say it is 0. So it will be something like this, 0.1, 0.9. That means for 0, it is having 0.1. For 1, it is having 0.9. Something like that. It's a probabilistic score for your binary classification. If you have more classes, it could be something like this, 0.5. So this means this is class C. Okay, the idea is this one. So I'm calling this, and based on this, if my single output is 1, this customer is likely to be churned. If it is 0, it is not likely to be churned. And here I am returning, because it's a API, right? I have created an API. I have created the function called as predict. The method is post method. I'm using the HTTP post method. Here I'm rendering template home.html. In the same HTML file, what is the output? Output is O1, output 2 is O2. What are the inputs? All these are my inputs. So let's quickly run this code, as we have already gone past the time. That's the reason I'm hurrying it up. Okay. I'm already in this particular file. Okay. So what I will do is, I will simply call my Python app.py. Okay. Before that, you can set the Flask debug as on. So you can set it as 1 so that your debug is on, so that on the go, if you find any issues, you can easily identify it. Okay. So I'm setting it as 1, Python app.py. Similarly, based on your use case, if you have 5 inputs, you can just keep 5 and ignore others. Accordingly, you will do the changes here. Okay, it's not going to be very difficult. Something is wrong. Let's rerun it. Okay. Okay, let's set the Flask debug as what? I hadn't saved the file, that's the reason it was not running, because the file was locked, I think. Wrong. Okay, it took a lot of time. Normally it doesn't take that much of time. So you can see serving flask app name, lazy loading, using production WSGI server instead. Debug mode is on, debugger pin, and running on this. Okay, now you can see this particular HTML file. What we are doing is, here we have defined a form action. Okay, here I have passed my input. Let's say tomorrow. Okay, let me just finish it and then I will explain that. So let's go to this particular location. Now you can see, obviously I'm not very good at the UI part, so I haven't beautified it. Obviously UI is not our part, right? We are just concerned about how to deploy it. Obviously when it comes to beautifying it, you might need a help of a UI or UX candidate who can easily beautify this particular HTML file using CSS scripts and all those things. Okay, so I will pass some information. Before passing, let's pass some real information of some real customers. Now, obviously this model is meant for people who are, obviously it will predict people who are getting churned or not churned. That's the main motive, right? But but we have to pass the customers who are active in the system. If we pass this customer who is already not active, who has already churned, there is no value addition, right? There is no importance. So let's run this particular customer who is still active in the system. Senior citizen, I will pass it as 0. Monthly charges, I will keep it open. Later on, I will give. Partner, yes. Dependents, no. Phone service, no. Multiple lines, no. Internet service, DSL. Online security, no. Online backup, yes. Device protection, no. Tech support, no. Okay. Streaming TV, no. Streaming movies, no. Contract month to month. Paperless bill, yes. Electronic check. Tenure was 2 years, I think. Monthly charges and total charges are same. Tenure is 1 year. Okay, it's 1 year. And monthly and total charges are same. Okay, simple. So what we are doing is, this is the front end. I have passed 19 attributes. You can see this HTML file. It is accepting 19 queries as an input. Okay, I have defined input query 1, query 2, query 3, till query 19. So what it is doing, it is taking these queries in this file. This is nothing but request.form query 1. So whatever we are passing in query 1, it is getting stored in query 1, and accordingly these are the query, we are using these values in the data and converting into, again, get dummies and all those things and doing a prediction, right? So let's submit it. You can see this customer is likely to be churned. Okay, so same customer based on the same model which we have created, it is telling that this customer is actually not churned. You can see this customer is not churned. It is still active, but my model is telling that based on the attributes, this customer is likely to be churned. The confidence is 80%. Okay, now let's pass some other customers' data which is not churned, and probably randomly let's pick this one, 11th customer, male. I will reload it. Okay. Senior citizen, male, gender male, senior citizen 0. Partner no, dependents yes, partner no, dependents yes. Tenure is 62. Okay. Phone service, yes. Phone service, yes. Multiple lines, no. Internet service, DSL. Yes. Yes. device protection, no. Tech support, no. Streaming, no. Streaming TV, no. Streaming movies, no. Contract is 1 year. Paperless billing is no. Payment method is this, no. Okay, and what else? Monthly charges is 56. Total charges is this one. Okay, let's do this. This customer is not churned, right? This customer is not churned. So let's do this. So this customer is likely to continue. That means this customer is safe. Could be multiple reasons. Could be of the contract. Could be of the higher total charges value. But this will definitely be intact with the EDA insights which we got. Okay. Whatever insights which we got here, it will be intact with that. You can confirm this thing as well. See, electronic check. This is not electronic check. 1 year contract are less likely to churn, right? That is the reason. Could be because of some reasons. This is telling that this customer is likely to continue. And the confidence is 24% basically means 24% churning confidence. That means 76% chances that is likely to continue. Okay. It's not 24% confidence to continue. Okay. It's the confidence of the churning. You can just tweak the code accordingly. So this is all about the model building part, model deployment part. I think within the given time, it was really tough for me. But I think you have got a real idea how things work in the real scenarios and all those things, right? That's it for today's video. That's it for today. Maybe I think I'll just wait for 2 more minutes. If you have any questions, you can leave a comment in the chat box. Or else if you have any questions tomorrow, you can feel free to connect me on LinkedIn. Most of you have my WhatsApp numbers, so you can feel free. If you are more into understanding this particular Flask part, I already have videos. I already told you, right? Somebody was asking me about PCA, that can we do PCA or not? Is PCA going to be important or not? So is anybody there who needs to see how PCA works in this particular use case? I can also do that for you. Anybody who needs PCA? In detail, if you want to know about PCA, PCA is nothing but a dimensionality reduction technique. PCA, LDA, kernel PCA, quadratic discriminant analysis. There are various other concepts which are there for dimensionality reduction. Where you have a lot of features, you might have to cut down the features, and you might have to apply PCA, LDA based on the complexity. They have their own pros and cons. If you want to go in depth of PCA, LDA, QD, again, I have the playlists for that. In the same description, you can go through the concepts. Okay, so the coding part, let me go through the coding part and let me explain you. The same model I will be explaining, I will be comparing it with. So let's try to implement PCA and see. Okay, apply PCA. So from sklearn.decomposition. PCA equals to PCA. So here, while declaring a PCA, you can call it in two different techniques. One is if you want to call it the number of components, so n components, or else if you want what should be the accuracy, based on that, you can also pass a value, 0.9, 0.8 or something like that. So let's pass 0.9. I will share the code as part of GitHub repositories. I will share the link in the description itself. You can check the video description maybe in next 2-3 hours. I'll probably have lunch and then I will upload the code, okay? So let's say I'm defining my xtrain1 equals to pca.fit transform. Let me write down the code and then I will explain you. Xtrain, let me. So I will be using xtrain and ytrain. Okay. Okay. So fit transform is done, and then xr underscore test one equals to pc dot transform x test. Okay, and then there is something called as explained variance. If you want, you can use it. But what here I have, what I have done is I have just fitted and transformed, because PC is a technique which you need to apply. So you have to fit and transform the training variables, the training data, and only transform the test data, because test data is not fitted in the model, right? Because it will be predicted. No, kernel depends. There are different other techniques. Kernel depends. You don't have to define it specifically. You can or you cannot, okay? And other than that, what else? What else? Well, let's call the model. Let's say model PC equals to random forest classifier. Let's use the same thing. Random forest classifier, model underscore PCA. Model underscore PCA dot fit. I will fit the training data and test data. Fit is done, and then y pred PCA equals to model underscore PCA dot predict on x test. Okay, so let's print the classification report. You can see with PC also, I mean, you can see the results. I mean, I haven't performed a SMOT. You can also perform SMOT and see, but this is how PCA works. So it depends. Some of the use cases, you can use PCA and get a better accuracy, but it's a hit and trial technique. You cannot tell that in which particular scenarios you have to use PCA or not, because PC is basically a linear technique, okay, linear dimensional reduction technique. Similarly, we also have LDA. The difference between PCA and LDA is that in PCA, while we just consider the X variables, we don't consider the Y variables in PC. But in LDA, we consider the Y variables as well. You can go through each one of the videos to understand more on PCA, LDA, QDA and kernel PCA, okay. But yeah, blindly, I cannot guarantee you that if you use these techniques, your model's accuracy will be enhanced. Sometimes it enhances, sometimes it's not. Somebody had asked me to implement PC. That's the reason I showed this, how PC is implemented. Okay, that's it for today's video, guys. I think it's a very prolonged session. Expected to finish it in 2 hours, but yeah, it has taken almost 2.5 hours to finish. Any questions so far? I will be sharing the codes, and I won't be able to share the slides. Maybe this slide I cannot share because it's related to my classes. This slide, to some extent, maybe to till fourth or fifth slide, I can share it with you. Okay. That's it for today's video. You have my number, you have my LinkedIn profile. You can easily connect me anytime, whenever you want to, for any sort of doubts. In future, that's the main motive of this particular channel, other than other channels who are more focused on some topics, in detailed topics. But yeah, my channel, I'm more focused on live sessions and live implementation so that people can join live. Obviously, my view and watch time will increase for sure. That's also one motive. But yeah, the main motive is to explain end-to-end projects. So I'll come up with a lot of topics in future as well. So thank you everyone for joining the session. Please join our Telegram group for future updates. I will leave the Telegram group's link in the description or in the comment section. Okay, I also have few sessions lined up on various other topics related to ANN, recurrent neural networks, sales analysis, time series forecasting. So my very next video is going to be on time series forecasting. Okay, and many more such topics in this channel. So please subscribe my channel to keep me motivated. Do share my videos as much as possible and like the videos. Thank you everyone. Good day ahead. Anybody who is willing to take some data science end-to-end courses or something like that, they can also consult me for any kind of suggestions. I will be able to help them. Okay, that's it guys. Thank you everyone. And Happy Sunday. Thank you, everyone. Time series probably next Saturday. But yeah, if you are in one of my groups, I will definitely update, or I will also update in LinkedIn. Okay. Thank you, guys. Thank you, everyone.